And also, I just want to make a comment now so I don't forget later. The envelopes that are in your bulletins are Peace with Justice Sunday, one of those special Sundays we take as United Methodists. And that offering goes to help people that in the United States and other parts of the world do different activities to work for justice and work for peace. So if you feel called to give to that offering, you can put it in the envelope and put it in our offering plate. Again, I want to welcome all of you and welcome Marilyn's back with us today. Her daughter's not here, so she's taken her place. So always good to have Marilyn back with us. If you would like to stand now as you are able, we're going to join in singing our Praise Hymn, Glorify Thy Name. Then we'll share the call to worship, and then we will sing the praise hymn, Yes, Lord, Yes. Please stand as you are able.
To God be all the glory, the one who visits us in three persons, the Holy Trinity of hope and love.
For there is no place which is without you, O God, and no time when you are not there. For you are the beginning and the end, the source of all that is the wonder of universal life.
And yet you take us by the hand and lead us, as the life of Christ walks our human way and shows us the life is stronger than death. We praise and worship you, O God, for there is no other God like you.
I say yes, Lord, yes, to your wind and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes. I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me with my whole heart. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When the Spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your wind and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your Spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your Spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes.
Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you, Merlin and Sharon, for leading us this morning in our praise song. In your bulletin and on the screen is our morning prayer. Would you please join me in praying? We honor you, glorious and exalted Lord, as creator and sustainer of all things, and as the one who has loved us when you had no reason to love. We honor you as the one who gives us meaning in our daily existence, as the one who has called us to be healers and peacemakers in our troubled world, and as the one who has gone before to prepare a place for the future. Help us during this hour of worship to catch a glimpse of that glory. Amen. We will now join in singing Holy, 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 and you remain seated for that, please.
Thank you.
Let's now share our joys and our concerns. I do too. Congratulations. Haven't heard that. Congratulations, Bernie. Thank you for sharing that, Kathy.
I'm going to spread all kinds of good cheer here in case other people don't know. The Riverside golf team yesterday played 7th in state, and Eric Rock tied for 3rd. And the Riverside soccer team won their game yesterday, and they'll be going to state. They won in a double overtime shootout, so that was pretty exciting. And my mom's birthday is tomorrow. And I know how you get people locked into their age, so I think she's somewhere around 62.
Thank you, Misha. While we're mentioning birthdays, I'm going to meet Norma's, of course, is tomorrow, like Misha said, and where are Andrew and Sarah? Today's your birthday, right? Both of you, right? Today's the day? Sweet six, really? Wow, okay. Happy birthday to Norma and Sarah and Andrew. Anybody else have a birthday this week that's here? I'm not aware of it if there is. Happy birthday to the three of you. I do have a few things to share, and you just keep thinking if you have something. Happy that Ward's able to be with us this morning, and Nancy is continuing to be in the hospital, so we just continue to pray for the doctors to be able to treat Nancy so she can go home. And just to let you know, too, Jim Johnson was in the hospital 2 or 3 days last week, but he's home doing just fine. So he just was going to rest a little today. That's why he's not here, but he's doing well. So we can continue to keep him in our prayers.
My dad's birthday's on Friday.
Jeff's birthday's on Friday, is that what you said? Yeah? Friday? Well, happy birthday to Jeff. Happy birthday. Thank you for telling us that. Happy birthday. Chris. I'm sorry, I said Jeff. I'm sorry. Oh, Chris. Oh, okay. Sorry. Okay. Happy birthday. So we have lots of birthdays this week. I do have, again, just keep thinking if you have anything. Jackie Scott Duhacek's sister-in-law that we've had prayers for a year. Sue shared with me that she has been placed on hospice, but they are hoping maybe to see some other doctors to maybe get some better word. So family has just asked that you would continue to keep Jackie in your prayers and all of the family, please. And just a reminder that June 2nd, this coming Sunday, a week from today, is Ed Kyle's retirement party in Carson. Also, there's other things to do that day. I was asked to share with you that the Riverside 20th year birthday party is also that afternoon, so you have a couple places you can go. It's in the football field. They're going to have a barbecue dinner. You can go swimming for $1 at the pool, and there are other activities, and that's, yes, Kathy?
Oh, stop.
No, that's okay. I was just going to say it was hanging on the little bulletin board. Yes, if there's more, you please tell us. I don't know all about it.
The admission to the pool is a dollar. However, if you will go on riversidelinks.com website, there is a coupon, and you can print out as many coupons as you need, and then it will be free. Just present the coupon.
Thank you. I wasn't aware of that. Thank you. And I am going to miss both of those events. I'm sorry to say that I'm not going to be able to be here for them, but quite a while ago I planned my vacation, and I will be leaving this Wednesday and flying out to Philadelphia with my son to see my daughter and her husband, and we're going to be there a week, so I'll return the following Wednesday. Pastor Brody from the Carson United Methodist Church will be on call, and his number was in last month's newsletter. It's in this month's newsletter, and Bernie has an additional number. If you're not able to reach him on those numbers, he has one that you could call him in case there's an emergency and you're in need of a pastor. Thank you for sharing that with us. We'll keep you in our prayers, Merlin. That will be a nice service, I'm sure. Any other joys or concerns this morning? If not, then let us bow our heads for a time of prayer. Dear gracious God, thank you for your love for each of us that is not dependent upon what we do or what we don't do. You love us unconditionally. How we wish we could love others with that same kind of love. Sometimes it is hard what you ask us to do. Help us to remember we are not alone. You have blessed us with the gift of your Spirit to help us to follow you and to do what you have asked us to do. Help us during this time of worship to feel your presence with us, and may we be renewed and inspired to go into the world to be your disciples. Thank you for our many blessings and the blessing of being able to speak freely to you about all of our concerns, God. Today we do lift up to you Nancy. We just pray the doctors can find an answer and help her be healed. We continue to pray for healing for Shirley and Sandy, and we do pray for Jackie, God, and her family that you'd be with her and keep her free of pain, God, and just hope that other doctors may have better hope for her, God. We pray that for her. We lift up Jim and just thank you that he's home and nothing serious is going on with him. We just pray for strength for him. We pray for Bev for her upcoming surgery, for the surgery to go well, and we pray for the healing time to go well for her. Just be with her and her family too, God. And we remember our soldiers and families, especially on this Memorial Day weekend, God. All those in the nursing home, homebound, that are not able to be with us, God, we remember them. We do pray for Merlin delivering the message today, God, that you will be with him. We pray for safe travels for all those people that are traveling this Memorial Day weekend. We lift all these prayers up to you today, God, and we again just thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness in our lives. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Please join with me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would the children please come up? Morning, Eric. Awkward. They're all coming. Morning. Morning, Anna. How are you? Good morning, Keaton. Hi, Naomi. Hi. Hi, Kyler. So, how are you today? Are you good? Oh, we have more coming. We should wait a minute. Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you. Hi. Morning. Do you want to come down this way a little more? Would you like to? Because I have something to show you. You might not be able to see it down there. You want to come down over here? Maybe? There you go. And then you can see better. That'd be good. Thank you. Well, first of all, do you know what a mystery is? A mystery, you've heard mystery, yeah? Like mystery books or mystery stories? I'll just read you this nursery rhyme. You can just say it with me. It's a really old, old nursery rhyme, and I bet you all know it. Humpty Dumpty, right? You know Humpty Dumpty. Should we say it together? Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty Dumpty together again. You know that one, right? Well, I found a book, and I read about it, but I couldn't find it to bring it to you, but it's called What Happened to Humpty Dumpty? And did you know his brother was a detective? Yes, his brother was a detective. And so he wanted to find out if Humpty Dumpty actually fell off the wall or somebody pushed him off. So he was going to figure out if maybe it was Goldilocks or Little Miss Muffet or the Big Bad Wolf that actually, or somebody else maybe, yeah, that actually pushed Humpty off the wall. So it's a good book. If you ever find it, I think you should read it. I'd like to find it. You could. You could check. Yeah, you could be an investigative reporter, right? Well, you know what? The reason I brought that up.
Wait. Since Humpty Dumpty is an egg, mm-hmm. I wonder if he'll find bacon at the bottom.
Maybe. And you know what? That was just the next thing I was going to say, Eric. I was going to say, what is Humpty Dumpty?
It's an egg.
An egg, right? So today I want to talk about another mystery, and it's kind of a mystery in the church. And it was in one of our songs we sang, and the word is Trinity. And that's a big mystery, not just for people your age, but for all of us. It's a really big mystery. Trinity's hard to understand. So since we talked about eggs, I brought an egg this morning, and I'm going to try to a real egg, a hard-boiled egg. And I'm going to try to explain.
Is it one that's still in a shell?
Yes, it's in a shell. Uh-huh. I am going to. Ooh, can you smell them?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I am going to try to explain the Trinity with the egg, okay? So how many gods are there?
One
God. Okay, that's what we need to remember, first of all. There is.
There's
there, right, others do. But we know that there is one God. One God. Yes, there. You think I know? Well, you watch and see if I know. Okay, so one God, okay? So we're going to kind of pretend like this represents God, okay? Okay, so what's the first part of God?
The shell.
Okay, so, all right. I'm gonna break it open. And is there something inside that shell?
Yes.
Okay, what's the part inside the shell, one of the parts? What's that part?
The yolk.
Okay, the yolk's in there.
The yolk is the yellow.
The yolk is the yellow, and there's the white part, right? So will you tell me how many parts are there to this egg?
Three.
The shell, the white, and the
yolk.
But how many eggs are here?
One.
Just one egg, right? But with three parts?
I know what this is.
Do you?
It represents God, Jesus, and the Holy Ghost.
Absolutely, that's right. So that kind of helps us, kind of, it's still hard to understand, that something can be one but still be three parts. So maybe that helps you understand when you hear the word Trinity, and we may not remember that word, but when we say that there are three parts to God, like you said, God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit, kind of like the egg. One egg, but three parts, okay? Kind of maybe help you remember. You are good listeners. Yes. Yeah, it would mess all over the floor, wouldn't it?
Or maybe.
today, whatever I did with my bag, oh, it's down there, thank you. Excuse me, honey. I've got a worship bulletin if you want it. It talks about Trinity Sunday, and inside here it shows a three-leaf clover as a way to kind of help you see about the Trinity too, right? Three parts, but one clover, right? So there's different ways to talk about that. So I'll give you one. We'll pray a prayer, okay, and then you can take one with you. Would that be okay? Can you pray the words after me?
Can I be second?
Yes.
Can I be second?
Yes. Should we pray the words? Okay. Will you pray after me? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
We love you.
We love you.
Help us to believe. In the Trinity. Even when it is a mystery. Amen. Oh, you are good listeners. There you go. Okay. That's right. You're right. There you go. Hi. Okay. Thank you, Eric. And in honor of Memorial Day today, Memorial Day Sunday, we will share our Memorial Day prayer. And the insert is in your bulletin if you would read the bold part, please. Almighty God, before whom stand the living and the dead, we, your children, whose mortal life is but a hand's breadth, give thanks to you. For all those through whom you have blessed our journey, whose lives that have empowered us, whose influence is a healing grace. For the dear friends and family members whose faces we see no more, but whose love is with us forever. For the teachers and companions of our childhood and youth, and for the members of our household of faith who worship you now in heaven. For those who sacrifice themselves, our brothers and sisters who have given their lives for the sake of others. That we may hold them all in continual remembrance and ever think of them as with you in that city whose gates are not shut by day and where there is no night. That we may now be dedicated to working for a world where your love and grace and peace abound. Amen.
The scripture reading this morning is from Peter chapter 2, verses 4 through 10, and can be found on your pew Bibles on page 1473. Come to the Lord, the living stone rejected by people as worthless, but chosen by God as valuable. Come as living stones, and let yourselves be used in building the spiritual temple, where you will serve as holy priests to offer spiritual and acceptable sacrifices to God through Jesus Christ. For the scripture says, I chose a valuable stone, which I am placing as the cornerstone in Zion, and whoever believes in him will never be disappointed. This stone is of great value for you that believe, but for those who do not believe, the stone which the builders rejected as worthless turned out to be the most important of all. And another scripture says, this is the stone that will make people stumble, the rock that will make them fall. They stumbled because they did not believe in the word, such was God's will for them. But you are the chosen race, the king's priests, the holy nation, God's own people, chosen to proclaim the wonderful acts of God who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. At one time you were not God's people, but now you are his people. At one time you did not know God's mercy, but now you have received his mercy.
Please stand for the gospel reading this morning from the Gospel of John. I I have much more to tell you, but now it would be too much for you to bear. When, however, the Spirit comes who reveals the truth about God, he will lead you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but he will speak of what he hears and will tell you of things to come. He will give me glory because he will take what I say and tell it to you. All that my Father has is mine. That is why I said that the Spirit will take what I give him and tell it to you. This is God's good news. And if you'd remain standing as you're able, we will join in singing Standing on the Promises. Each year, around Memorial Day, veterans of foreign war members and American Legion Auxiliary volunteers hand out millions of those bright red poppies, right, in exchange for contributions to assist the disabled and hospitalized veterans. I'm sure most of you probably already knew that, but you may not know the history behind the red poppy. I didn't know, and I apologize if some of you already know that, because I'm just going to share it with you briefly. The story of the poppy began on a Belgian battlefield during World War I. Trench digging, battle action, and burials disturbed the poppy seeds that were in the ground. A Canadian medical officer named John McCrae noticed how the poppies had sprung up around the graves and crosses, and he was inspired to write a poem about the poppies and the soldiers who had died. Years later, a woman by the name of Monia Michael, inspired by McCrae's poem, conceived of an idea to wear red poppies on Memorial Day in honor of those who died serving during the war time. She was the first to wear one, and she sold poppies to her friends and coworkers, and the money benefited servicemen and women in need. The red poppy serves as a memorial to all fallen soldiers. We are familiar with memorials, right? There are countless memorials in our country. 2 years ago, when I visited my daughter in Philly, we went to New York, and at that time, the World Trade Center Memorial was under construction. And if you want to see several memorials in one place, just, you know, go to Washington, D.C., where you can see the Washington, the Jefferson, the Lincoln, the Holocaust Museum, World War II, and Vietnam Veteran Memorials, just to name a few. There are some, what I would call, kind of some odd memorials, too. I was looking at some pictures of different memorials around the world. I saw a picture of a memorial, and it is a memorial. It's located in St. Thomas, Ontario. It's a life-size elephant, would you believe? And the name of the elephant is Jumbo. He was a circus elephant, and unfortunately, he was killed in the town in a railroad accident in 1885. So they built a life statue of Jumbo. And of course, there is that very unique memorial to the boll weevil. Maybe you've heard of that in Alabama. So some unusual ones. The fact is, memorials are not new. They have been around for a very long time. In fact, you could say they're as old as Methuselah. In the very first book of the Bible, Genesis, is a story about Jacob placing a type of memorial in the place where he had a dream and heard God's promise to him through that dream. I'm just going to share a little bit of that with you. It's from the 28th chapter of Genesis. Jacob left Beersheba and started toward Haran. At sunset, he came to a holy place and camped there. He lay down to sleep, resting his head on a stone. He dreamed that he saw a stairway reaching from earth to heaven, with angels going up and coming down on it. And there was the Lord standing beside him. "I am the Lord, the God of Abraham and Isaac," he said. "I will give to you and to your descendants this land on which you are lying. They will be as numerous as the specks of dust on the earth." And then later on, it says that he took the stone that he was laying on and said, "This memorial," and that's the words he used in the Bible, "this memorial stone which I have set up will be the place where you are worshipped, and I will give you a tenth of everything you give me." So because he met God in that place, he made it a type of memorial to God. This stone memorial and others like it were visible reminders to God's people of God's faithfulness to them. When the Israelites first crossed the Jordan River, they set up a stone monument to serve as a reminder to all those who would pass through the future generations. And this event is recorded in the book of Joshua. This is when Joshua and all the Israelites were traveling to the promised land, and the priests were carrying the Ten Commandments in the Ark of the Covenant. Well, they had to cross the Jordan River, and it was flowing at that time. It was the time of the year when it was flowing. God told them that he would stop the river flowing, but first he made them step out in faith. The priests that were carrying the Ark of the Covenant, they had to actually, the Bible tells us, put their foot in the water, and then God stopped the waters from flowing, and they all passed safely. Well, when that happened, God instructed them to choose 12 men, one from each of the tribes, and command them to take 12 stones out of the midst of the Jordan. And they built a type of memorial with those stones, and Joshua told the men the stones would remind the people of what the Lord had done. In the future, when their children passed through, they would see the stones and they would hear the story of how God was faithful to the people and helped them to cross safely. Some people plant trees in memory of people they want to be remembered. After the terrorist attacks on 9/11, federal grants were made available to develop living memorials, tree plantings, to provide long-lasting tributes. Abraham of the Bible planted a tree in Beersheba, and that's in the Bible story as well. He had made a covenant with a man named Amalek at that place, and so he planted a tree as a way to recognize that covenant he made with this man, but also as a way to recognize God's blessing and God's faithfulness to him. So a tree for him was a memorial. And this was in Beersheba. And I want to tell you something I learned this week that I thought was very significant. And very shows us how connectional we are with all people in the world. I learned this week that 3,000 trees are being planted in Israel to memorialize the Newtown victims. The trees will be a part of Beersheba River Park, the same place. It's now a river park, a development area in Israel's desert city, the same city where so many years ago Abraham planted this memorial tree. So now there are going to be 3,000 trees there in memory of the people that lost their lives at Newtown and the young people. Jesus himself instituted a type of memorial, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. In Luke's gospel, Jesus, after taking the bread, giving thanks, breaking the bread, giving the bread to his disciples, he tells them, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." These were Jesus' exact words. Memorials can remind people of what has gone on during their time here on earth, and after all the witnesses have passed on, after all the people have gone from this earth that were witness to that event that's being immortalized, or that person, then they serve as a reminder to generations to come. I wonder if you have ever been told that you remind someone of a relative who has passed on. Probably most of you have. I think that's pretty common. It has been nearly 20 years ago when I had a cousin approached me and tell me that I reminded him of our grandmother. 20 years ago, so think about that. Now, to be honest, I wasn't too thrilled to hear that. I was still pretty young, or I considered myself pretty young at that time, so I really did not appreciate being told I reminded him of a grandmother, even if she was my own grandmother. And things kind of come around. A few years ago, a woman I knew approached my daughter. We were standing together, in fact, at the Atlantic United Methodist Church, and she hadn't seen either one of us for a while, and she came up to us, and she looked at my daughter, and she said, "You look like your mom." Immediately, I could tell by the look on my daughter's face that probably wasn't the best news she had heard that day. And when the woman walked away, I tried to comfort my daughter by saying, "Don't worry, honey, you don't. You really don't." Sometimes it is because of the way we look. Sometimes it is our mannerisms or the way we talk that causes people to be reminded of others. In a way, we are all what I want to call today living memorials. I remind people of my grandmother, and again, I'm pretty sure all of you here remind someone of someone else. And since this is church and we are all Christians, I would like us to take a little time this morning to reflect on how we remind others of Jesus. We should, right? Remind others of Jesus. The scriptures tell us we should. Ephesians 5:1 reads, "Since you are God's dear children, you must try to be like him." The lesson from 1 Peter that Craig shared with us this morning refers to us as living stones. That's what we were called, living stones. We are told to let ourselves be used in building the spiritual temple. We are to live lives worthy of our calling. So what does that mean exactly? Lives worthy of our calling, to live life that way and in a way that we resemble Jesus. Well, I think it means, just to name a few, telling the truth when it would be easier to lie, loving when we would rather hate, forgiving when we would rather hold a grudge, sharing what God has blessed us with instead of saving it all for a rainy day, speaking out against injustice, even if it means you may lose some friends in doing so, being patient, even if it means you have to count to 100 lots of times, sharing words of hope, even in the midst of despair, stepping out in faith, trusting God to be with you even when you are afraid, seeing possibilities in impossible situations, and having compassion for people who are suffering, even if it's because of their own poor choices. You have probably heard this saying, "You may be the only Jesus people will see." A little girl kind of said it this way. I want to share this brief little story with you. One Sunday, as they drove home from church, a little girl turned to her mother and said, "Mommy, there's something about the preacher's message this morning that I don't understand." The mother said, "Oh, what is that?" The little girl replied, "Well, he said that God is bigger than we are. He said God is so big that he could hold the whole world in his hand. Is that true?" The mother replied, "Well, yes, honey, that is true. But Mommy, he also said that God comes to live inside of us when we accept Jesus as our Savior. Is that true too?" Again, the mother assured the little girl that was the truth. With a puzzled look on her face, the little girl then asked, "If God is bigger than us and he lives in us, wouldn't he show through?" And that's the point, isn't it? If we are Christians, when people see us, Jesus ought to show through in our homes, our offices, our communities, and in every aspect of our lives. We should think and act like Jesus in the way we live our lives, so when people see us, they will no longer see us, but see Jesus living within us and loving them through us. In ending this morning, I want to share a story with you. It was written by a girl named Allison Asmakopoulos, a long Greek name, I believe. But she reflects on her life as a Christian and what it would mean if people saw Jesus in her. So I just want to share that with you in ending. "You don't think the teacher will hear us, do you?" my lab partner whispered to me. We were watching an extremely boring video on the lifestyle of the cell. Instead of taking notes, we were talking. "Nah, I don't." Before I could finish my sentence, I looked up and saw the teacher standing over us, giving us a very stern look. "Just kidding," I blurted out, not sure why I even said those words. I guess it just seemed to be the best way to lighten up what could turn into a tense situation. "What did you say?" my teacher asked in a tone that seemed more surprised than angry. "Just kidding. You know, you sound like the girl who sits in your seat the period earlier. Come to think of it, you two sound a lot alike. I'm sure you must be friends with Lauren." "Well, yes, we're very good friends," I answered, relieved the teacher seemed more interested in me and my friend than in the fact that I had not been paying attention in class. After the period ended, Lauren and I met up so we could walk to our next class together, something we always do. Next to Lauren was a girl who was new to our school. After Lauren introduced me to her, the three of us walked down the hall together. As Lauren turned the corner to go into her classroom, she shouted above all the hallway noise, "Meet me by the pop machine," I shouted back, finishing her sentence. "Of course." The new girl was staring at me. "I can't believe it," she said. "You guys finish each other's sentences and keep changing subjects so fast that no one can keep up with you." That's when it hit me. What if I knew Jesus as well as I know my best friend? I thought about what it would be like to be able to finish his sentences, to think his thoughts, to laugh his laugh, to smile his smile, to cry over things he cries over, to care about the things he cares about so much. And then I thought about how my teacher and the new girl sort of saw Lauren in me, since we're so much alike. What if people saw Jesus when they saw me? What if I were so close to him that my life looked a lot like his? I still have a ways to go, but I really want to build that kind of relationship, the kind that will make people stop and say, "Hey, you remind me of Jesus. You two must really be close." And all God's children said, "Amen." It is now time to take our offering, and I will just remind you that if you're giving to the Peace with Justice offering, you can put that in the plate now.
Thank you.
Let us pray. In response to your generosity, sometimes received directly and sometimes received through others, we return these gifts with our prayers, our devotion, and our enthusiasm. Amen. Thank you. In honor of Memorial Day Sunday, let us now sing America the Beautiful. Thank you for joining us for worship day. We invite you to stay for a time of fellowship and refreshment. Go in peace. May the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the comfort of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you for always. Amen.